At the end of 1972, Barbara Ward could look back at what had been a very successful year with some satisfaction. The UN Conference on the Human Environment had been a great success. The book that she authored with René Dubos for the conference, Only One Earth, Care and Maintenance of a Small Planet, had been published to great acclaim. A potentially disastrous boycott by more than half the world's nations had been avoided. The Group of 77 had threatened to boycott the conference, saying that it was a northern agenda. Barbara Ward had worked hard behind the scenes to avoid this, and Only One Earth included the key development issues that were the main concern of the Group of 77. She had set the foundation for sustainable development in 1972, as she said that the charge of the UN to the Stockholm Conference was clearly to define what should be done to maintain the Earth as a place suitable for human life, not only now, but also for future generations. But she was struggling with cancer, wanted to return to England. Into this came an invitation from the International Institute for Environmental Affairs to become its president. This was a new institution headed by David Runnels, who had been one of her grad students during her time as professor at Columbia University. She agreed but asked that the name be changed to the International Institute for Environment and Development and that the institute move to London. 1972 was also a time of growing disquiet that international aid focused too much on the big infrastructure, the ports, the dams, the airports, and not enough on meeting people's basic needs. For instance, for water, for sanitation, for healthcare, for schools. There was the worry too that the new concern for the environment was also ignoring meeting basic needs. Hence, there's a fantastic challenge to the new institute to show how environment and development issues can be combined and should be combined. So Barbara Ward returned to England. She worked mostly from her home in a small English village, for much of the time bedridden. I was her research assistant for her last two books, and I had this wonderful office in her attic with an amazing view of the English countryside. Meanwhile, David Runnels built the institution in London. Five features of the emerging new IIED remain and have served the institute well. Bring in remarkable people. Jorge Ardoy, truly the outstanding urbanist of his generation, accepted Barbara Ward's invitation to join IIED and form a human settlements program. So he set up our sister institution, IIED America Latina, and he built a very influential program of research and support for action across Africa, Asia, and Latin America. Jerry Leach, all 6'7" of him, was invited to develop an energy program that included a very innovative, path-breaking, low-energy strategy for the UK in 1976, and an assessment of deforestation in Africa that showed the importance of reforestation. Anil Agarwal, really one of the world's best-known environmentalists, was invited to IIED's Media Information Unit, EarthScan. He then returned to India to set up the Center for Science and Environment that was to become one of the most influential NGOs. A second feature of work is work in partnership with Global South organizations, including civil society. You can't do research on the Global South stuck in the Global North. This was to become a characteristic of much of IIED's work, the working with local partners. The Human Settlements Group, for instance, was formed by research institutes in India, Nigeria, Argentina, and the Sudan. The third feature, convene strategic meetings. Barbara Ward convened or chaired so many critical meetings during the 1970s. These brought together the world's best specialists from the North and the South. They issued recommendations that were to influence international discussions, agendas, and institutions. This includes the meetings just before the global UN conferences on food and on human settlements. The fourth feature, which Barbara Ward exemplified, was tenacity. Keep going, keep pushing. She was certainly a powerful influence on getting more attention for water and sanitation through highlighting this need over the years in her books and articles, in her briefings for prime ministers and presidents, through expert meetings mentioned already, through her address to the plenary of the UN Conference on Human Settlements, at which ambitious targets for improving water and sanitation were endorsed by all governments. The fifth feature was working with and serving the press. Barbara Ward was an accomplished journalist as well as a development specialist. She reached huge audiences through her popular books. Only One Earth was published in 13 languages. She could write in the Economist supplements about the different UN conferences. She wrote often in the Washington Post. And she supported young journalists through press briefings and study visits. Sometimes the subtlety of her language eluded understanding. The UN Environment Programme had supported the preparation of her last book, Progress for a Small Planet. We sent them a copy of the manuscript. The only comment we got was, remove racist text on page 191. But we turned to page 191, we scratched our heads, and what she had talked about is the not entirely unastute Japanese as a very elegant and sweet comment on their astuteness. It was misunderstood. We had to remove it. So perhaps there's a sixth feature that we inherited from the early 1970s of our sister institution. When asked about the possibilities of getting needed change in global and local environment and development, she said that it was our duty to hope. It was our duty to hope.